All right, hello everybody. Welcome to another installment of the Fall Environmental Resilience Speaker Series, jointly presented by Indiana University's Integrated Program on the Environment and the Environmental Resilience Institute. I'm Janet McCabe, I'm director of the Environmental Resilience Institute, and I'm really pleased that you're able to join us today. Before we start, I'd like to acknowledge and honor the Indigenous communities native to this region, and recognize that Indiana University Bloomington is built on Indigenous homelands and resources. We recognize the Miami, Delaware, Potawatomi, and Shawnee people as past, present, and future caretakers of this land. Both IPE and ERI are founded on the understanding that interdisciplinary learning and research are essential to teach today's scholars and to solve today's problems, not to mention tomorrow's. The natural and social sciences, the humanities, and the arts are all critical and in play as we tackle climate change and the environmental challenges that are affecting our health, our communities, and our economy here in Bloomington and around the world. IPE was founded in 2012 by the provost and the leadership of the O'Neill School, the College of Arts and Sciences, and the School of Public Health to bring together all of the environmental and sustainability scholarship across the various schools and departments on the Bloomington campus. The ERI was founded in 2017 as part of the IU Prepared for Environmental Change Grand Challenge. Its mission is to enhance resilience to environmental change in Indiana and beyond by accurately predicting impacts and effectively partnering with communities to implement feasible, equitable, and research-informed solutions. IPE and ERI faculty, staff, and students have worked together to bring us a full semester of speakers. We'll round out the fall series on December 4th with a talk by President of Keep Indianapolis Beautiful, Jeremy Kranowitz. And next semester, we'll continue our series beginning January 22nd with former Indiana Congressman Phil Sharp, who's been the CEO for Resources for the Future. That will be a great talk. You'll be able to find information about each talk on the ERI and IPE webpages and in our regular newsletters and upcoming events notices that our organizations regularly send out. And we encourage you to sign up for our newsletter so you'll get reminders about these upcoming talks as well as other news and events we publicize. If you have ideas for people we should consider for a future talk, please tell us that too. So a few obligatory logistical details. Whoops, I don't wanna spoil the surprise here. Please mute yourself. We can do it for you, but we'd rather not have to. Please put questions into the chat box as you think of them, and we'll monitor them throughout the speaker's talk, and there will be an opportunity for questions at the end. We suggest that you watch this on speaker view so you can see the slides and Cynthia most clearly. So now at long last, what you've been waiting for, I wanna introduce you to Cynthia Giles. You can see information about her on the screen here, so I am not gonna read that to you. How tedious would that be? But I will say that I had the utmost pleasure of working with Cynthia for 7.5 years during the Obama administration. She was one of my absolute favorite people that I got to know at EPA. She was the head of the Office of Enforcement and Compliance Assurance. And for those of you that have been in government, maybe there aren't any on this call other than me, but enforcement people are a particular breed of people. And Cynthia is just one of the most thoughtful and engaging people that I know who has worked in the enforcement world, but man, you do not want to be on the wrong side of her. And I often speculate to myself, I imagine Cynthia having conversations with her grandchildren, telling them what they can and can't do. And I think you will get a sense of that very, very quickly when she starts her talk. The work that she's been doing since leaving the Obama administration is, I think, groundbreaking and really important if we are to design regulatory programs that actually achieve the goals that they're supposed to achieve. And she will lay all of that out for you. She's been having some technical difficulties, so I'm going to be sharing her slides. So please forgive as we manage that together. And with that, I will turn it over to Cynthia to start talking, and I will switch the slide deck.
Thank you so much, Janet. It's really fun to be able to join you in this And I just want to tell folks that working with Janet was one of the highlights of my time in the Obama administration. Never have air and enforcement worked so closely together, I think, before. And you are just incredibly fortunate to have someone so smart and dedicated. And she's mean in the gym, I just want to say, too. It's really fun for me to be able to be back with you, Janet. And I'm sure we're going to have no problem navigating these slides, just as we've had no difficulties navigating the many challenges we had together for many, many years. And I want to thank Janet for being so patient with me. I've been yammering in Janet's ear about this topic for a long time. She's been very patient and listening to it. So next generation compliance. This could easily, talk could also be called, why do we have so many environmental violations? And what can we do about it? So the next slide, just to give you a little bit of background about where I'm coming from when I'm talking about this. So as Janet mentioned, I was the head of enforcement in the Obama administration. But prior to that, in my career, I've been a civil environmental prosecutor. I ran an enforcement program for an EPA region as a career person. I ran a state a water protection program, and I've worked in the NGO world. And the reason I'm mentioning that is to say that my background is broad, and I have been in the trenches with individual violators, and I've been at the top levels of policy. And I'm going to talk to you about, next slide, what I have observed during that, unfortunately, 30 years now time working in environmental policy. There are two commonly held beliefs. The first is that most companies comply. You hear this everywhere. Lots of people say it. NGOs, government, everybody, they say this. Most companies comply. There may be a few bad apples. There, you know, maybe some companies, especially smaller companies, maybe not all complying, but most companies comply. The other widely held belief is that compliance is the job of enforcement. That the program offices set standards and they write the rules, and then they hand it over to the enforcement folks whose job it is to find the violators and take enforcement. That view that compliance is the job of enforcement is so deeply ingrained, most people don't even know it is a belief. They think it's just the way things are. It's like gravity. They assume that without discussion. So next slide. Unfortunately, probably won't surprise you to hear that I mentioned that, because in fact, both of those beliefs are wrong. In fact, serious violations are widespread. They are widespread for all sizes of companies, all business sectors, all different types of rules. They are common in, serious violations are common in programs to limit the amount of pollution that is allowed. They are common in prevention programs, which are designed to prevent there ever being pollution, like hazardous waste transportation rules, for example. And they are common in monitoring and reporting obligations, which is how government even knows what's going on in the world. So over the course of my career, I have asked a lot of people, including people who spent their entire profession doing environmental protection, what's their guess about how common it is to have serious violations of environmental rules? The most common response I get is people guess serious violations are maybe 5 to 10% of the companies. You wish, okay? It is nowhere near that low. Serious noncompliance, 25% is the norm across all programs, and many are much, much, much higher than that. The other belief that isn't correct is that compliance is really the job of enforcers. In fact, it's how the rules are written that determines the compliance outcome. If the rule has lots of opportunities to evade or obfuscate or avoid, you're going to have serious noncompliance. The design of the rule makes all the difference. So next slide. So why do we care about this? So what? That there's so much widespread serious violations. One is that there's a lot of pollution out in the world that people are being exposed to. So this is a map of non-attainment areas in the United States. I think the most recent numbers, it's about 130 million Americans are living in areas that don't attain air quality standards. About 50% of our surface waters are listed as in poor condition. So there's a lot of pollution problems that these violations are contributing to. The other is that there's lots of programs that don't fall in the bucket of traditional air and water pollution where people are exposed and they're serious health threats. So lead paint, as this photograph is showing, is one great illustration of that. You know, that's not a conventional, that's not what most people think of when they think of environmental protection, but those kinds of programs make a huge difference to people's lives. And environmental justice is very central to this noncompliance problem because it's the overburdened communities that get hit the hardest with these violations. So next slide. So what can we do? So what I've been writing about and working on since I left during the Obama administration, but more aggressively since I left, is what is the answer to that? How can we do a better job in rules to prevent these kinds of violations and what I call rules with compliance built in? So next slide. So the way the way this resonates for people the most, I think, is to see specific examples. Like what's an illustration of a rule that works well because of next gen type things and what's an illustration of some rules that don't? So I'm going to go through very quickly, very superficial, high level view on four programs, two with good outcomes and two with bad, to show you what we're talking about here. So starting with the ones with good outcomes, there's two examples, acid rain and a pesticide, an herbicide called paraquat. So next slide, starting with acid rain. So acid rain is the literally acidic rain that was falling on big parts of the United States. You can see in that map there in the red area, huge, huge problem. And the principal contributor to it was sulfur emissions from coal-fired power plants. And so Congress said, hey, we gotta do something about this. We gotta cut that the sulfur dioxide emissions from those coal-fired power plants. So how are we gonna do that? Next slide. So what came out of that was the acid rain program, which is for anyone who's at all an environmental rule aficionado. You've heard of acid rain because the main thing it's well known for is its market feature, capping the emissions and allowing the utilities to trade to reduce the cost. That's its most famous feature, but that's not its most important feature. And that has nothing to do with why the rule succeeded. You can see on the map there, this program really did make a huge difference in the sulfur dioxide emissions and acid rain, and really is a master class in good compliance design for a rule. So we're not gonna talk about cap and trade because it's not relevant to compliance questions. So next slide. Here's the features that were in this program that made it so amazingly successful. The first is continuous emission monitors. So these are just monitors that you put in the stack of the power plant that measure how much sulfur dioxide is coming out of there. And they do a pretty good job at it. So actually monitoring, not guessing, not estimating, actually monitoring. Next slide. So how do you get the companies to actually maintain those emission monitors so that they're working and they're working properly? Here's a brilliant idea that was included in this. Substitute data requirements, which says, say if your SEMs are down, if they're not working right, or they don't pass quality assurance, you gotta assume you had a lot more pollution than you probably really did. So the company is very motivated to keep those working. And next slide. And then adding to that, you require electronic reporting of all this data. So it allows all the data to be centralized, available in real time, and it allows data checks and data analytics and tools to verify the information the companies are submitting. Next slide. And then here's a very important and an underappreciated a next-gen driver provision and rule, simplicity. Okay, so the underlying problem is very complex. Running and maintaining these monitors is complex. Hundreds of pages of guidance are needed to figure it out. But the rule design itself is very simple. It says, do you have one allowance, which is worth a ton of emissions? You have one allowance for every ton you emitted. Yes or no? Compare column A to column B. It's very hard to miss if you had a violation. It's very, the design is elegant to make compliance very easy to determine. Next slide. So the outcome of all this was 99% compliance. That's, you know, those are numbers we can only dream of in other programs. That almost never happens, 99% compliance. And the last feature that was, there were many others too, but the last feature I want to mention here that was cool about this is automatic penalties. So you compare column A to column B. If you're short, you're in violation, you're short on your allowances, guess what? You have an automatic penalty to pay for that shortage. And the amount you have to pay per ton you're short is way more than it would cost you to go out and buy an allowance. So why wait and pay more? It's cheaper just to comply. So all these features together led to this 99% compliance in the coal-fired utility sector. Okay, so that's the acid rain example. And remember that when we're going to circle around the second to coming back to the coal-fired power sector for a program that was in the bad examples category. But first, a quick word on a completely different type of problem, paraquat. So paraquat is a herbicide that is used as a weed killer, very commonly used, but it is also incredibly toxic. One sip can kill you. And for that reason, it's a restricted use pesticide. You have to be a certified applicator to use it. And part of the rules about this herbicide are that you are not allowed to pour it into, you wouldn't think you'd have to tell people this, but you're not allowed to pour it into, say, a beverage container to apply it or store it. Nevertheless, even though it's unlawful to do that, people do it. They do it routinely. And 17 people died from accidental ingestion of paraquat that had been poured into beverage containers, including one 8-year-old boy who found a Dr. Pepper bottle in his garage that his brother had put there, who had obtained that paraquat, by the way, from a certified applicator. And the 8-year-old drank the paraquat and died. So what is EPA going to do? So next slide. So warnings aren't working. There's these big skull and crossbones. There's all this, don't do that. The rules are very clear, but people were still doing it and children were paying the price. So EPA adopted a different strategy for paraquat that said, okay, we're not going to depend on you using good judgment. The rule now says it's impossible. You have to design your packaging for this herbicide such that it is impossible to transfer it to a container like a beverage container without completely destroying the whole packaging. So don't rely on good judgment. Just make it impossible. So that's another next gen type of an idea that thinks a little bit outside the box of how are you going to prevent these problems and not rely on someone to come in behind and try to enforce them. So those are the two good examples. Next slide. And here's now a couple with pervasive violations and a look at what was it about the design of those programs that led to such significant problems. And the first one is lead in drinking water, which we as a country are unfortunately way too aware of these days. And the second one is coal-fired power program called New Source Review, which you're going to be happy to know. You don't need to know anything about New Source Review to understand this example. Okay, so the first one, next slide, lead in drinking water. So what's the problem? So lead is not usually, practically never, is lead actually in the drinking water that gets shipped out of the water treatment plant where you get your water. The lead isn't there. How the lead gets into the water is it leaches into the water from lead that's in pipes or in fixtures in your home. So that's a very complicated problem. So the way the drinking water standards address that is they say you have to treat the drinking water with materials that make it less likely to leach lead out of the pipes. And it's called corrosion control. And that's the principal strategy for dealing with lead in drinking water is corrosion control. The next slide. So what actually has happened with the implementation of this rule? The rule contains a requirement. It's an obligation, a legal obligation, enforceable, that the drinking water systems are supposed to sample to check if their corrosion control is working. They're supposed to sample at the places they are most likely to find high levels of lead. And they're supposed to report in that that's what they're doing. One study that looked at all the drinking water systems in a state found that 50% of the drinking water systems were not in fact sampling at the places most likely to find high lead, although they claimed they were. So there's a big hole as to how is the lead in drinking water being implemented. The other one is that the standard is not set, it's not a fixed number, a parts per billion type of thing. It's a what percentage of the samples are over a certain level. So those of you who've taken math in grade school will know that you can change your percentage by just changing the denominator. So let's say you found 5 bad samples out of 100. Now you've got 5% that are bad. Okay, that's no good. Take a few more samples that are going to be clean. And now your 5, same number of bad samples, is no longer 5%. And this is such a well-established practice that it has a name in the drinking water program. It's called sampling out. Lots and lots of systems use it. One study that was done in one state said at least 30% of the serious violations were masked by this sampling out strategy. So there's lots of ways to avoid finding the violation by the system. And then the program sets up a lot of motivation to use them because the cost of compliance are very high. And the drinking water systems know that it is very tough for the state, which is the principal regulatory authority, very tough for the state to find a problem if the drinking water system's not giving them the correct data. So the systems are very reluctant to raise their hands. Next slide. So what's the net effect of all of this? Well, I'm sorry to tell you, we don't really know what the net effect is, because one of the problems of all these regulatory design challenges is that the government doesn't really know how bad the noncompliance is. But here's one data point. Remember, in the last slide, I was talking about how states aren't even going to know that there's a lot more violations of this, that are happening than the states even know about. But EPA has done some audits of the state's data to say, all right, how are you doing? The ones you do know about. So, okay, there may be a lot you don't know, but the ones you do know about, are you telling EPA about them in the way that the rules require? Okay, the answer to that is no. No, they are not. The most recent audit that was done of state data said 92% of the lead in drinking water violations were not reported EPA. 92%. So when you look at the national data that EPA posts on its website about how we doing with lead in drinking water, yes, that's the data EPA's got. So they're providing what they have, but it's nowhere near, not close to what the real violations are. And the reason is all of these regulatory loophole problems that make it very, very easy for systems to avoid and for states to avoid owning up to the violations. Okay, so that's one of the tough, next slide, one of the not so good examples. And moving on to the second and last example is new source review. So new source review was Congress basically looked around and said, geez, we got a lot of really bad air pollution. There's a lot of it. And we've got we know how to address a lot of these violations. There's some modern pollution controls that could make a huge difference. In many cases, they can reduce the pollution by like 95%. I mean, a huge, huge difference for the types of pollutants that have some of the biggest impacts on public health of anything that EPA regulates. So Congress said, all right, here's what we're gonna do. Anytime you update and modernize your plant, you're gonna install the modern pollution controls. So over time, it was envisioned over time, we would clean up the existing fleet. We're talking here about coal-fired power plants, but applied to a lot of other industries too. But here focusing on coal-fired power. Over time, as you modernize and update your plants, you're gonna install the modern pollution controls. And that way we'll have gradually improving air quality as you do that. So if you were gonna design a program to say, how could I have the worst possible compliance outcome in this program? It would look a lot like a new source review. So what are the features, next slide. So what are the features of this program that led to such catastrophically bad compliance? One is it was very, very difficult to determine what rules applied to which plant. It was very fact specific as individual. There was a lot of details. There was a lot of huge amounts of data necessary. So it's very complicated to determine when did you modernize sufficient to be obligated to put on the modern pollution controls. Every decision was plant specific. So there wasn't a standard way to determine that. You had to dig into the facts of any individual situation. And there was almost no reporting. So all the data that government would need to figure out if a particular plant was supposed to be modernizing was held by the company. And they weren't gonna turn it over without a fight. And then on top of that, harking back again to the drinking water situation, the controls were very expensive. Worth it, because the public health benefits were gigantic. But they were expensive. So the companies were very motivated to find a way not to have to comply. The net effect of all of these many pathways around, through and under was huge. The serious violations of this became the norm. Over 70% of the top 25 coal-fired power companies were in serious violation. I just want to remind everyone, this is the same sector as the acid rain program with the 99% compliance, the same company, same sector. The problem is not the sector. The problem is the rule and whether it gives them a way out or it doesn't. So the next slide. So what EPA decided to do, looking around and looking at all the violations and the gigantic public health impact of all these violations, EPA decided, okay, we're gonna go after them one at a time. So we're gonna use the enforcement tool and we are gonna just go after them one at a time. And it was totally worth it because the pollution reductions were gigantic. Public health benefits were huge, but it massively labor intensive and expensive undertaking to bring all these cases. 20 years and counting that EPA has been at the job of trying to enforce this standard. It was one of the former enforcement officials described new source review for coal-fired power as the tobacco litigation of environmental protection. You know, people were just avoiding their obligations. They were knowingly avoiding their obligations and they waited to be caught and forced to do it, which EPA did do. But it's the exception that proves the rule. It is almost never possible for EPA to obtain compliance in a sector by going after facilities one at a time. That is just, there's millions of facilities in the country that are governed by EPA rules. The one at a time strategy is a one-off. It's almost never possible to do it through that kind of brute force method. Okay, so next slide. So there's the examples I just explained and many others are posted on the Harvard Environmental Energy Law Program website. And That's in the first paper and the second paper that's posted there. In case you thought those examples were outliers and actually compliance is a lot better, no, unfortunately, no. There's serious noncompliance is widespread. And this second paper, noncompliance with environmental rules is worse than you think, goes into all the data. As I said before, serious not just any violations, not talking about minor things, serious violation, 25% is the norm. And many have serious violation rates in the 75 to 80% range. And unfortunately, lots and lots of them, we don't really know how bad the noncompliance is. And the lead in drinking water is one illustration of that. So the next slide. So, what have we learned? How can we test whether a rule is going to be compliance resilient and it's going to be able to obtain good compliance rates? And here's one way to do that is for the people designing and writing rules, ask themselves this question. If the regulated parties want to avoid complying, are there many ways to do that? So I am not suggesting that they want to violate. I think that's very rarely the case. They don't want to violate, but they're not making compliance a priority. They don't want to be in violation, but they're also not doing what's necessary to comply. So what we have learned is if there are many ways to avoid complying, there's lots of ways around created by the rule, you can count on it. There are going to be a lot of violations. So next slide. So what can we do? There are lots, many, scores of ways to build compliance into rules. Many, many ways. I'm just going to give you two, one high tech and one very low tech idea. And it's going to be included in my writing to go through a lot more of these in more depth. So on the left there, one of the key ideas, central ideas, we saw this with continuous emission monitors in the acid rain program, is measurement. Measure the pollution. Know what's happening. Don't guess. Don't estimate. Actually measure. And on the left there, those two bar charts, what you see is this was an attempt to actually measure VOCs from refinery flares. And on the left in the blue, the small blue is the amount that they were estimating there were VOCs being emitted from those flares. And in the red is the actual amount of VOCs coming off the flares. That's a pretty big difference between what they were estimating and what really was happening. And in that difference, in that delta, is a giant amount of public health concern. Okay, so that's a more high-tech monitoring thing. On the right-hand side is that they're not all high-tech. So in the state of Ohio, they imposed a requirement for sewage treatment systems that they had to go to all the outfalls. Those are those, you know, the pipes that come out of the sewage treatment plant that discharge into surface water. They had to post a sign that says, see this pipe? See this pollution coming out of here? This, we own this. Here's who we are. Here's our phone number. And that's posted at every outfall. And it turns out that the sewage treatment companies really don't want to get a lot of phone calls from people complaining about the brown foamy junk coming out of the pipe. And they cleaned up their act. The imposition of the requirement to post these signs improved compliance. So the next slide. So there's a lot of strategies that can work, okay? But some things never will. Chief among those is a strategy that counts on, it puts the entire burden on government of finding all the serious violations. That's never gonna happen. That strategy is doomed. You will never get good compliance with that strategy. The honor system, just saying, here's what you're obligated to do and hope for, cross your fingers, hope for the best, also doomed, okay? The evidence just doesn't support that that assumption is warranted. Widespread violations are the norm. The assumption of compliance is not warranted. And the last thing that will never work is assuming that enforcement is gonna come in behind and fix these problems. That's we've never seen that work yet, with the single exception of new source review, and it took 25 years to do it. So that's not a good plan. So next time. So I just want to say here, so that there is no chance of my being misunderstood, because when I talk about next gen, sometimes people say to me, oh, so you're saying enforcement's not important. No, I am not saying that. Enforcement is essential. It's a must have. You cannot have an effective compliance program without it. But what I'm saying is enforcement alone will never be sufficient to make up for the gap that is created by a rule with bad compliance design. So next slide. So there's one other article already posted, which is the IDLogs, Performance Standards and Market Strategies, which is about the policy orthodoxy that has swept through the environmental policy world, that market strategies are, you know, the next thing since sliced bread, and everybody should do market strategies for every problem. And it takes on that that point of view and explains why that's not a good all-purpose solution from a compliance perspective. Next slide. The next article that is coming applies next gen to the challenge of our time, climate change. We cannot afford to repeat the mistakes of the past when the opportunity is now upon us to do something about climate change. We can't afford to repeat those mistakes in the rules that are coming up. NextGen is agnostic on ideology. And it just asks one question: is it gonna work? Will you get the emission reductions that you're aiming to get out of this rule? And the climate article comes to the conclusion of yes, some of them can work quite well. With a few additional provisions, they can work quite well. But it also says some of the most popular climate ideas cannot. So watch for that. That's coming next. Next slide. The other things that are coming, I'm working on a book on next gen with Oxford University Press. Other things are gonna be covered in the book. One is, so if this is such a great idea, why isn't EPA doing it already? And one of the reasons is a guidance that's EPA requires EPA rule writers to assume 100% compliance, just assume it. So has encouraged EPA to live in the fantasy world where 100% compliance is free. So that's been part of the barrier. Next slide. One of the things that we have to do to implement some of these next gen ideas is update federalism. We are still living with the federalism model from the 1970s when EPA started, and it's time to modernize that. And next slide. The last part of it is environmental enforcement. Environmental enforcement, must have, essential. What does environmental enforcement look like in the next gen era? So last slide. So why is this important now? A few reasons. One is, as we all have just lived through so viscerally in the last few weeks, we are in many ways, divided nation around some of the topics that are most central for protection of public health. One of the advantages of many of the next gen ideas is that they're not easily classified as regulatory or anti-regulatory. And that is a huge benefit in today's political climate. And my personal experience has been that states of all political stripes can get behind many of the next gen ideas because they want to be effective, and they can't be labeled as regulatory or anti-regulatory, so that there's no political blowback. So these ideas have potential even in a time of division in our country. And we are, the second reason is we are now at the moment. This is the moment when it's possible to make a change and do something different. It is vitally important that we not think we're not going back. We're not going back to how things used to be before the last 4 years. That would be a giant mistake. We need to go forward and adopt and modernize the environmental protection enterprise writ large. And nowhere is that more important than in climate change. Our time is up. This one's got to be right. No time for mistakes. This has to work. And I think that some of these ideas will help us get there. So if your last slide is if you're interested in any of this stuff and find it intriguing, if you want to go and take a look at the papers that have been posted so far on the Harvard website, the address is there.
All right. Well, thanks, Cynthia. That was great. It really took me back. For those of you that might be interested in reading Cynthia's papers, she writes the way she talks. So they're really very enjoyable to read and not your typical academic journal type writing. I'm now going to check out the chat bar and see what questions we have. One question we have is, for those of us working outside of government and policy, what can we do to encourage compliance? Do societal norms or consumer pressure play a role?
They do, provided that the people who are writing the standards build those in. And I think one of the principal ways that citizens can help is by raising their voice and an expectation that government's going to do something to protect them from pollution and these other risk problems. And so if a rule is designed for a consumer-facing product, which is not all of EPA's rules, by the way, a lot of the companies the EPA regulates are not consumer-facing, like coal-fired power plants. Don't interact with you on a regular basis, but some of them are. And if government does its job to design the rule to make the most use of that consumer pressure, then you as a consumer can really make a difference by paying attention to that information that you get and making your buying choices based on it. But I would say equally important to the consumer side of things is your voice as a citizen, that you expect and that your government to have your back and to take care of these problems. That's government's job and they should be doing it. And if you raise your voice and tell them that you're expecting them to, that helps.
Yeah. What about local governments? And we know that the national environmental laws are implemented mostly by the states and by EPA. What's the role for local governments?
Local governments have a gigantic power because at the local level, the people who run local governments are, you know, geographically very close to the people who operate these different facilities, whether that's small facilities to even the largest ones. The people who work in those facilities are members of the community in most cases. So local governments have a lot more clout to put pressure on facilities to do the right thing than they necessarily exercise, even though sometimes, yes, they're federal standards, still companies are very susceptible to local pressure. Plus, I would say the other thing that can happen locally is individual tools to apply that pressure are very possible. They're not regulatory tools, but not all problems are solved through regulatory tools. Sometimes, you know, public pressure is more effective than a regulatory tool. So what's stopping any local government from saying, here's our worst 10 polluters in the town of X. Post that up on your website. That'll get people's attention. Those kinds of things, you know, if you think creatively about what can be done, there's lots of ways to intersect with these facilities to get better performance.
Yeah, I think that's right. And I think transparency and shining a light on performance in a way that the public has access to, which is so much easier now that there's electronic reporting and there's websites and people are used to finding information on websites. There's really lots of opportunities there. And programs that EPA has run for years, like the Toxics Release Inventory and others, where companies have to report and they get ranked. And they really don't want to be the
right.
The company in the country that emits the most toxic pollution of everybody.
It certainly is interesting. Contrary to maybe what some people may think, the power of being on one of these top lists actually does drive company behavior to a surprising degree. They really don't want to be on those lists.
Yeah, yeah. I want to remind people, if you have a question, please put them in the chat. Here's another one. You mentioned federalism and our notions of federalism are sort of antiquated now. What does modern federalism look like? And I'll just mention too that during the Trump administration, especially when Scott Pruitt was administrator, we heard a lot about cooperative federalism and how EPA under Obama was not respecting the state's role. I'd throw that into the question as well.
So I am a huge fan of cooperative federalism. That's the model that almost all EPA programs are built upon. The basic construct is you need federal standards because people everywhere got to be protected the same. And you need state involvement because every place is not identical and things need to be adapted to local circumstance. The interplay between the federal standards and the state implementation has resulted in what I would consider to be creative tension. Okay, there's creative tension in there, has ever been thus, and so will ever be. The federal and the state governments don't always see eye to eye on what should happen. That's fine. That's not a problem. States lead in some cases, the feds lead in some places, and they both learn from each other. So where things need to be updated, I think, is the model that we first adopted for federalism at the, in the 70s, really, was that all these facilities were going to report to the states. And then the states were either going to know what, massage, do whatever they are going to do. And they will tell EPA about whatever they decide to tell EPA about the information. I mean, yes, they're supposed to pass everything through. Okay, they didn't really do that. Okay, they haven't been doing that. Program after program, it doesn't happen. That doesn't work that way. This is, that might have been, one could debate, but that could have been maybe a reasonable model when everything was on paper and the forms were all going to be mailed into a local state office. Okay, that's not the world we live in anymore. It is nuts, insane to have a system where all the facilities in the country report to the states and then the states are hesitant and reluctant to share any of that information with EPA and limit what EPA can share with the public. That is crazy. So we need to be moving to a model that says the facilities are gonna all report electronically into a central system to which EPA and the states and the public will all have access. That's just a different model. It's not the state as controlling access to information, which why would we have that? We are a joint system of governments to protect the public. The public's entitled to know about this information. It only makes sense that we share it because why wouldn't we? It's easy to do. There's no paper involved. Everyone should know the same thing, and we're going to have more accountable and more transparent governance and better pollution control, not incidentally, if we do that. So I think it's a shift that has started to happen. It happens in the water arena. EPA adopted a rule that basically shifted to that model for water programs about 5 years ago. And we need to do this. I mean, drinking water, the lead in drinking water is like a great illustration. Why should it ever be possible that states know about, 10 times the violations than is being shared with EPA and the public? That should never be possible today. We can't have that. So we need to change the model and open the thing up in the way that electronic information makes possible.
Yeah. Well, here's another great one. I've thought about this myself a lot. How does enforcement deal with accidental emissions related to natural disasters? And there will be more with climate change. Do you strive for a balance between strict enforcement and forgiveness, or because time's up with climate change, do we hold the line, and can next gen solutions help?
Answering the first question, the last question first, yes, next gen solutions can help. And it's so great to get a question about this because this is a really important part of EPA's mission to deal with these kinds of problems. And it's outside of the box of your standard, you know, water out of a pipe and air out of a stack, but far more of EPA's work is involving these types of issues than in just the standard types of air and water pollution. What we discover when we see horrible accidents, or when we see really bad things happen as a result of a natural disaster coupled with a facility's stored chemicals, or for example, what we typically see is those companies were not complying. Okay, that was not just some act of God, who could have ever predicted. No. Lots of times the reason that those horrible things happened is that the companies who were supposed to be checking for corrosion in their pipes or checking to make sure the valves weren't open or doing a host of other things that are preventive in nature, they weren't doing them. And it's the nature of preventive programs that some of the time you don't do the preventive thing and there's no price to pay. Because the horrible thing that you're trying to protect against didn't happen, so you're okay. But then there's going to be the time when that horrible thing does happen. And the fact that you are caught short and you were not doing what you were supposed to be doing, combined with this external force and pressure, is what created this bad problem. Most of the preventive rules are designed with exactly that kind of thing in mind. It's not like no one's ever thought about what'll happen if we have a flood. What's going to happen if there's hurricane? No, I mean, there's places in the country that get those things all the time. So the rules say you have to be anticipating that. You got to do this whole variety of things that are designed to make people, allow people still to be safe from the chemicals or process or whatever you do, even though this bad thing has happened, because it's not unpredictable or unforeseeable exactly when and how it's going to happen, yes, but not that there will be things like that, no. So what EPA typically finds is that there was a violation underneath, that a violation of prevention obligations that led to this. So this is right up the alley for NextGen, is to say, well, how are you going to make that? How are you going to change the dynamic there so that we aren't in this pattern of no one knows if you're violating these prevention things until the catastrophe strikes, and then the chemicals are all released and the people are all exposed, and now we're going to come after you with enforcement? I mean, yes, do we have to do that? We do. But that's not sufficient. That's not okay. The people who are exposed don't find that acceptable outcome. We have to do a better job of making sure those things don't happen. And that's what NextGen is for, is how to use the right tools and levers of government to create the situation where you have far, far fewer of those kinds of horrible problems.
Yeah. Well, let me ask you one more question that I think springs from that, which is the examples that you share are great, both pro and con. And I've been involved in some rules that where really creative ideas came forward that I think were right in the space of next gen. But it's hard. It is not the traditional way that regulators at the state or the federal level think about writing rules. So how do you insert the creativity? How do you bring the creativity and the different perspective? And I'm wondering if you know, some of our academic colleagues who sit around and think outside the box maybe more than government regulators, maybe should be sitting at the table having these brilliant ideas. Maybe we should just do it this way.
Well, I would say two main things to that. One is sort of the inside the room strategy is we need a way to work into the rule writing process. That question that I mentioned earlier on in the presentation of, are there ways for people to get around this? Stop and think for a second. Are there? And my experience has been when I talk to folks who are in the room writing rules and that you ask them that question, they think, yeah, okay, but that's not going to happen. And it's like, oh, no. You're wrong about that. If there's a way around, that is going to happen. So it's getting people to understand that they need to think about their job in a different way. And the other thing, this is sort of my next gen mission writ large, I guess I would say, is to change those foundational assumptions that just about everyone involved in the environmental protection web of people who are focused on this, just about everyone believes. And have people stop saying most companies comply. That's wrong. That is wrong. So we should just stop with that as an assumption. And we should stop with the, you know, when there's these big catastrophes or there's, you know, some horrendous, you know, criminal act and everybody turns, you know, all the eyes pivot to enforcement and say, what are you going to do? I'd really like at that time, if all eyes would pivot to the people who wrote the rule and said, what is your problem? Okay. Why did you permit this to happen? Then I think there would be a different attitude maybe among the folks who write the rules, that the assumption that compliance is the job of enforcement is wrong. Yes, there's a role, important role for enforcement, but the reason we have all these violations is we didn't do a good enough job designing the regulatory standard.
Well, this has been great, Cynthia. Thanks so much for sharing your thinking with us. It's great and I think new and different for a lot of the people who are listening. So keep it up. People check out her papers and come back and join us in December to hear Jeremy Cranham.
Oh, yeah, I'd love to.
That was beautiful. All right.
Thanks so much for asking me.
Bye everybody.